Hi everyone and welcome back. Welcome to my another video of building API platform. And in the last video, we have covered building the API platform using Node.js, Express, TypeScript and Mongoose. Now, this is another video on top of that where I'm going to build API platform from the scratch. And what I'm going to use, Express, TypeScript, Mongoose, and we are going to write test. We are going to create a production ready API platform. So you might have seen my channel that is full of NestJS content, and people often complain, okay, why I'm not having so much on the Express. So the major difference is when we compare, I'm not going to talk about NestJS and all. When we talk about this is a NestJS piece and this is your Express, right? These are like two major placeholders we are talking here. So when I talk about Express, I feel like it's not properly opinionated. You can design the Express API platform in your own way. And this is the NestJS. And this is the Express. It's unopinionated framework, which can be designed, which can be architected in its own way. Where the NestJS is a modular approach and everything is structured, right? So that is the major difference. We often see NestJS is also built on top of Express only. We just added typings and all the TypeScript flavor on top of Express. Now, what is the major important aspect? You already know I have covered NestJS microservices, building the REST API platform, GraphQL API platform using NestJS. Now, this playlist, I'm covering something from the basics. So I'm going to cover a production ready API platform using Express. You might have seen the Express API platform, Express repository using Express.js, Node.js, having a different folder structure, different strategy, random folder structure, random router controller services, middleware. So I'm going to give you the final clean approach of building the API platform using Express. That you can use anywhere because it is going to include each and everything, the tests, the how to populate the environment variables, the best strategy to have the your applications split into different environments, the migrations, how to deal with the different database ORMs, right? So what we are talking here is, this is a simple Node.js app instance we are going to create. If I talk about the building blocks, what all things we are going to have. So Node.js is the runtime, and then we have Express.js, and Express.js uses all those things. On top of this, it is using controllers, and there is nobody defined, okay, this is the controller structure and all, because this is totally based on how you want to create it. And then there are models, services, factories and all. If you are using database, then you can create a models, you can create services. And then on top of that, because you'll be writing APIs, you need something to validate the data, validate the environment, validate the payload, then write the migrations into the database, writing the queries. So you'll have a DAO layer. All those concepts are like we are going to use in this. So what I'm saying is, this application you can use anywhere as a production ready application. So first of all, we are going to talk in theoretical what are the core dependencies we are going to use. It's a Node.js TypeScript app. So I will first put that in the headline, Node.js Express TypeScript with Mongoose. Mongoose is because I'm covering lots of aspects here. I don't want to make it complex by using TypeORM or SQLize or Prisma. Okay, this is what we are covering. Now, on top of that, what all major core dependencies we are planning to use? First, let's talk about them. That will help us to understand what we are going to build. So let's talk about the dependencies. Here I'm trying to document a couple of them and try to read them. So obviously we need Express because we are using Express Web Framework. Let me try to increase the font so we can just read it properly. So one is Express. And then we will first talk about, okay, what are the core dependencies, and then dev dependencies, cookie, parser. Then we have body parser, cookie parser to extract the cookies from the request, body parser to extract the request body extract the body from the request. Then we are going to use bcrypt instead of crypto to create the hash value of the password. And then class validator. Why I'm using it? Class validator, there are different options to validate your payload. Jord, I'm just putting uppercase. Jord, class validator and class transformer. These are the modules which you can use to validate your request payload. And then there is a .env we can use to populate the environment. Right? .env. So you will create a .env file and then that will help you to populate your environment variable into process.env. Then 7 is JSON web token, because here we are going to create this as a token based authentication. And Mongoose, which is ODM for connecting to the MongoDB database and all. So class transformer, class validator and class transformer. I mean, they comes in the pair, class validator and class transformer. If you are already aware about NestJS world, then this is something which is being used extensively to validate the payload. You can also use Joy and Jord. So cookie parser, body parser. So these are the main dependencies. And then in the dev dependencies, what all you will use? Dev dependencies can be many. The primarily what all dev dependencies we are going to have in our project, we will try to document them. So first of all, we are going to use jest and types jest, because we also need jest typing. We are using TypeScript and then Husky to create a simple hooks. We already have that in the monorepo at the root, so we don't need to use it. So I will just try to add what all types we need. So we need Mongoose, we need types, cookie parser, I think that is a type, and then types jest, types express. So you should be familiar, like, okay, these are the type definition packages which you need to add if you are using TypeScript. So you also need a types node, because node also comes with its own typings. Types super test, because we are going to make end-to-end tests. There we are going to make API call. Node mon, just to restart our server whenever we are changing our code. So that it will be a part of dev dependencies. And this is node mon, and then we have a TS node in TypeScript. TypeScript is also dev dependency. Why? Because finally we are going to, what we are going to deploy? We are going to deploy the dist folder or build folder, not the TypeScript code. So TypeScript we are going to use just for the build. And then we just need to use a TS lint and all, which are already there at the root. So types Mongoose, cookie parser, jest, body parser, node. So these are the different dev dependencies primarily we will have in our project. So what are we waiting for? Let's get started. So this is our code base which we are already using. I will just open this in the terminal. We are starting from the scratch, ground zero. There is nothing right now inside this, right? PNPM init. That gives me these dependencies, and now I can just do pnpm add, first of all, the code dependencies, bcrypt, and then JSON web token, and I have a mongoose dot env and class validator, class transformer, and body parser. There should not be any typo. Body parser, bcrypt, cookie parser. Okay, these are the code dependencies which we are adding. So let's go to the package JSON here, and I can see those has been added. So if anything is left, we will add it. Class validator, transformer, cookie parser, .env. I will try to zoom the code whenever needed. Here you can see all these dependencies, JSON web token, express. Okay, we missed express, that is the main dependency. Okay, JSON web token, .env, and then got it. So now we need to add the dev dependencies, and how we do it? PNPM add, I think there is a minus d we need to add. I will just try to play with this command and see if it is adding something in the dev dependency. Yes, it is adding the node, right? So similarly, we can add the typings for express types jest super test ts node typescript and some of the typings which we need. Super test types mongoose, and we need types for express node, we already have covered. Types we need for cookie parser. Let's see, we'll add the remaining. So because the typings for JSON web token also needed, so I will just add PNPM add minus D, and here I will just add the typings for JSON web token because we need to create a token based authentication. So typings for cookie parser, express, jest, JSON web token, node, super test. Okay. And we also need a node moon. TS jest is also needed because we are writing the jest for TypeScript code. TS node we already have. TS node and TypeScript. That's it. So these are the dependencies we have for dev dependencies. So I think now we have all the dependencies. Now we are going to add a script. So okay, what will be our main file? Main file will be src. Inside that server.ts. Let's call it as a server.ts because we are writing TypeScript code. And here I will just add a namespace for it. Expression prod ready app. Okay, and test we can just use jest command for it. Jest is a test runner that is enough for running, doing everything. And for running devs, I mean, you can use node moon. For that we need to create a node moon.json, or for the dev we can use this ts jest command which will keep running whenever you change the code. Or if you just wanted to run the TypeScript file, then you can do it something like this, server.ts. So this is dev command, but it's not watching. So for that you can also create a node moon. Node moon we created in our last code. I can just copy the same. So here I was using node moon.json. I can use that, and this is src server.ts. okay, it is also using ts node. And for if you want to run the application using start dev, or you can say dev watch, keep running it and watching it also, then you can use node moon command. Okay, so it is using this test is jest, and then linter and prettier we already have at the root. Now if I just do, you can also do pnpm install at the root, so this namespace will get added in the PNPM log YML. So here you can see express.js auth. I think because we changed it, express.js auth API, TypeScript API, and here we changed it just now. Express for prod ready app. So I will be just doing PNPM install. It is express TypeScript. Okay, Husky install, everything is good. Now if I try to see NX console, I always need to select the workspace. I don't know why. So this is my workspace, and this will start coming maybe because this NX console had some bug or something. It didn't detect the NX stuff in the first go. Or I think there is something missing. NX.json is missing, which we didn't add. That's why. So NX console is just for, we are using as a monorepo tool. Okay, and these are the applications. We can do the whole development inside these folders also. Like, okay, I will open this in the integrated terminal and I will start doing, okay, npm run test. Currently we don't have anything in as a test, so it will throw error. Npm run dev watch. Okay, node moon, it will look for the server.ts file which is not there. So we'll start creating folders inside this. Let's say src, and I will create server.ts, and I can just run now the dev watch. It has the file, but there is nothing is running, so it will exit right away. Okay, we also need to add nx.json file because we are using PNP. So this is the PNPM workspace. We can use get the advantage of this monorepo tool nx. So for that, what we need to do is we already have, I think, nx module added. Okay, it's not there. So we will add the nx at the root. And for that, we just need to add PNPM add nx. Okay, I think we need to add minus w because I'm adding that to the workspace. So you need to add a w flag because I'm adding it to the root. So we need to be sure that we are adding it to the root of the project. Okay, nx has been added. It can be dev dependency. Why do we need it as a dependency? So I'll just remove it. And I will do PNPM install again at the root, and everything is sorted. Now I also need to add, because you can see these commands are popping up, but we also need to add nx.json file at the root. I mean, this is just additional step, nothing to do with the API platform we are doing. So I will copy my nx.json at the root here. What it contains, it is just because nx is a monorepo tool which can automate the execution of the tasks. That is what it is doing. And now if I do go getting started, or maybe when I restart the project, then it will start coming up like showing all the projects here. Or maybe I will just reopen the VS Code. So this is what I was talking about. This is the nx cloud, all these scripts which are there at the root, because this is what I wanted to use in my project. So here, from here, we can control lots of things. Dev watch, I can run this. This is the monorepo tool that will help you to run the different scripts or different commands across different projects in this workspace. Okay, like this auth has a start command which is already there. I mean, it needs a Mongo DB. It's running, right? For now, I'll cancel it, everything. And then what do we need? We need a Docker Compose YAML file. So I will just see if my Docker Compose app, because till now we are using just MongoDB. Docker Compose app, that will give me a MongoDB container. If it is running, we are good. That's it. So this file nx.json, it's a default file. What it is saying is I can do all these cache for all these operations. So when you do npm run test at the root or in any of the project, then it will cache that operations, and whenever you are executing next time, it will be returning it from the cache. So it is like automating and fast execution of these npm scripts which we have across different applications. Currently we have three, there can be hundreds. It's like a monorepo. Nx is a monorepo tool, and it's this currently is a workspace, PNPM workspace. So that contains the packages and the application. So let's start building our application. So everything is ready, we have all the dependencies, we have all the scripts ready. We are using Jest for this writing the tests. We can write a unit tests and integration tests, because that is important when you are building any production ready application. So you make sure you are writing enough tests to cover some of the cases. Okay, so here I'm going to start with the folder structure first. So we can have app.ts where I'm going to initialize lots of things. Server.ts we already have. I will be creating the folders. Let's say what all entities and all these attributes we are going to have. So there are two different approaches of creating the folders. What all I'm going to have, my structure is I will be creating the domain based approach. I will be creating, okay, post is my entity. Let's say I will create a post folder, and inside that I will be creating all the files for it, because for the post API routes I need a post controller. I'm going to follow the approach of NestJS. But it's not a NestJS, we are writing Express. Post controller. And you will see this NestJS logo coming up, but so you can just ignore it. So post.model.ts. Okay. Post dot interface.ts if you have some DTOs or some typings. Post.controller, and then we can also have post.model, post.dto. That DTO we can use, it's not the NestJS DTO first of all, just a file naming, DTO controller interface and model, because the same you can adopt in any of the Express application to have a proper opinionated folder structures. Okay, this is the post. Now there can be another entity, like let's say user. I'm going to have the same structure there. I will copy these stuff to that and will rename the files. So here it will be a user controller. User DTO, because we can also write some authentication APIs, and then user, once user is authenticated, user should be able to create post, update post, delete post, these kind of structure I'm planning to build. And then at the root, because either you can create a folder, or at the root you can just add all the other things. Let's say I have authentication. Authentication will also have its own tests, middleware and all, authentication service. Then we have all the exceptions can be added here, the custom exceptions. Then we have, what else, utils we can create. We don't have a shared and core modules because this is Express. Then we have middleware, and all the services will be part of this. Okay, now this is pretty much we have. In the model we are going to create a mongoose models, and the controller will be, either you can create a DAO layer also here with this, like we have user. So you can also create another class which can call, which can talk about user service. User service is responsible for giving you the data you need. Okay, it will be just doing a find all the different methods, which is just doing a find, update, insert, delete for the user entity. Same for the post entity. If you want to create, you can create it. That depends how you isolate things. User dot service dot ts. Similarly, we can have post dot service dot ts. So what we are going to build? We are going to build a simple authentication APIs, and then once user is authenticated, user should be able to access the post API. And here we are going to use the classes, no functions. So we will understand how we can use this TypeScript classes to build the production ready app. Okay. And we also need a jest config. So I will add that at the root. Jest config will tell me, okay, what is the environment we need to use, and TS config, that is important, right? So I will copy the TS config from here. This is the compiler configurations which you need to compile, right? So this is the TS config. I will try to show you what TS config contains. This is just a compiler option. Okay, I'm going to create out directory dist, base URL is source. You need to include all these files, exclude node modules or any other tests you can include. And that's it. Okay, now we can start writing our code for server.ts. So in the server.ts, we are going to just only initialize things. All the responsibility of the controllers, authentication, all these will, we are just going to call them from here. And here, we are just going to create the app instance. So first of all, let's say we can create app that can be a class app. So you might see some totally different structure which I'm going to use here. Public app, because we need to create an app instance, right? So here we need Express. So it's a TypeScript. We will import Express, import everything as Express from Express. And here this app instance which I'm declaring inside a class should be of type Express application. Right, and then how I'm going to initialize this using constructor. So what you can do is this dot app equal to Express, simple, right? And you can see who wrote this code for me. Okay, I will try to just show you the extension. I mean, it was done by tab 9. Tab 9 is actually AI extension on VS Code. That will just give you, okay, what code needs to be go there. Now, inside this constructor, we can do lots of things. We can register all the middlewares, okay, connect to the database, initialize middlewares, all those things we can do. So I will just call that method. This dot initialize middleware, and I will be passing. So this dot initialize middleware, we can have method inside this. This dot initialize controller. So at the app bootstrap, it will check everything. Okay, and this dot initialize error handling, that also you can do. And you are going to create methods for all of these things. And controllers we need to import, right? What all controllers we have. So for that, we are going to create a interface. At the root also, we need to create interfaces. We can create interfaces, exceptions and all. And here I need to pass the controllers. So in the controller, so this is the interface. Here I can create simply controller interface.ts. So we are just using class way of doing it, import router from Express. So first of all, let's get the router. So we are going to pass two things using this interface controller. There is a path. Okay, what is the path of the controller and the router? We are going to pass the router instance. The router is of type express router. And then export default controller. Okay, go to your app.ts, and in the initialize, because what we are initializing the controllers, so we will just get the types from here. Import controller from, import controller from, and there is a path it needs. So what do we have? Interfaces, controller interface, and then this controller we can pass inside this. Here we need to pass the controllers array, because whenever we are going to initialize, this is actually a type we have imported, and this is type is controllers array. So who is going to call this class inside server.ds? We are going to do. So this is our server.ts. Here, how I'm going to do it. Let's do that. App const app equal to new app, right? We already have this app file, app component. And where is app? First of all, let's import .env config at the top. .env. And then I will just import app instance from my app file. And what it is giving me? It is giving me the app instance, right? What happened? App.ts. Everything is inside source, server.ts, import app. There's no default export. Okay, I will add it. Export default app. Now I think it's good. Now here inside this, what I'm going to pass, if you see, I'm going to pass the controller array. So we are not writing NestJS, we need to pass the objects, okay, of all the controllers we are going to create in our application. So I will be passing that, just specifying them here, and then app.listen. So app is going to be the instance of Express. So if you see what this app is going to return, this app instance is going to return Here, this is the app instance, and once you got the app instance, here you are going to define all the methods, public relation. So I can call this method, because this is not app.relation. I'm just using some strategy based on class, otherwise this is simple. Process.env dot port, and then this is the callback. So this is my app.relation method, okay? And if anybody wanted to get the server, then they can use this, because at the root level we are going to have only one server. Return this dot app. Okay, and that's it. So how we can do it? This is going to return in the server.ts app. So we can call this method app.relation. That's it. So your root server.ts will contain only this thing, all the controllers, and app.relation you will pass it. And inside app.ts, now you are going to initialize all these. You are going to create all these things, initialize middleware. So these can be a private methods. We are using class initialize middlewares. What happened? Now let's add this in the known. Okay, so here you can see this is tab 9 express.json app.use. I mean, we can just use body parser and all these middlewares we can register here. So what all we need body parser, cookie parser, and mongoose. All these I will import on the top, and then I can register it. So I need a body parser.json, and then cookie parser I need to register. This.app.use I will be calling cookie parser. I registered at least these two middlewares. You can use express, helmet, content security policy, CURS, all these middlewares you can add here. That we can do that. So private, and then I will have private initialize controllers. What is another method is initialize controllers, and I'm passing the controller array. So let's do this controller, and it is taking controller argument, controller array. Right, so what we are going to do is, how we are going to register them, we just need to do app.use, and then right, so controller dot, I can just do for each, because we need to iterate on to the controller array which is being passed, and then this dot app.use, this dot app.use. Okay, this is how we register a middleware, right? And then here we pass path and your controller dot, there are two arguments controller contains. This is the type, it contains the path and the router. So controller dot will have this controller is an array, and okay, controller instance, this can be controllers s. This can be simple controller. So controller dot, I can just pass router. Okay, this is how we can register the middleware, register all the controllers. This is how we are registering the all the middleware. So these two are sorted, and this we need to pass the controller, whatever we are receiving while calling, and then initialize error handling. So we can use the error middleware. We will be defining that for that. Initialize. Okay, so next we need is this initialize error handling. I just fixed the typos, so this is also a private method. And what we need to do for error handling, obviously we need some kind of a middleware, right? That we are going to register here, or you can say register error middleware. And how we do it, equal to this dot app dot use. And we will just pass error middleware, which we need to create. But this is how this looks like. Okay. And also we need to have another method is connect to database. That is first thing, right? This dot connect to database. So we won't be starting the server until unless we are not connected to the database. So private, connect to database, and how we connect, we can just use mongoose.connect. So here this is coming from our AI, right? And these are the options we need to pass. And okay, because if it fails, let's see how we were connecting. It is returning a promise, right? So mongoose.connect, that's it. It actually returns the promise. So if anything happens, if it throws any error, we would know. I just need to pass the options so I can copy mongoose.connect. We have a local instance, so we don't need to pass the options. We can just pass mongoose.connect. Okay, so this URL we need to put inside our env file. So we already have env. We need to create .env file here. An env example for you guys to take a reference. So inside env, we need this particular variable, MongoDB URI and port. And MongoDB URI I can steal from here. I can use the same, even the secret value. So it's a Mongo URL, not MongoDB URI. I can change this variable name. That's it. So this is my app instance, which is pretty much simplified with the classes. Okay, I just need to register some middleware. And what happens to this? Okay, module resolution options to node next. Okay, let's see this. Because it is complaining, there are many different ways to import a particular module, right? This is a duplicate. Body parser, did you mean to set module resolution option to node next? Let's fix this. So in tsconfig, we can set module resolution. Yes, next. Let's see if these errors are gone. So we are writing made app.ts. Cannot find body parser. What happens? Okay. Is it like we don't have a typings for it? So let's see this in the package JSON. Do we need typings for the body parser? Okay. 1.20. I will check that. What is the issue here? So we created an app instance, and in the server we now can import all the controllers. So rest of the thing is creating these controllers and just writing the services. That is the important thing. Okay, so let's try to see how much we have done, and we'll try to run this. So what I did is body parser, there is some typings issue still, so I'm just importing them using ES5, like a common JS way of importing things like the mongoose and the body parser. Okay, I will fix that once we have it. So I can just run the project using NX console. Okay, where is my NX console? This is my NX console. I can do dev watch, and let's see if we are able to start our server. Okay, it is starting the server. I'm fine with the warnings. So it had started our server. We can also app.listen, and here we can just do console.log. Oh, and this is a typo. Console.log. Application started on port. What is a port? Process.env.port. And if nothing is specified, we are going to start on 3002. So we should see this message, application started on port 3002. We are good, right? So now we need to create our controllers, all the middlewares and all those things. That is the next part. Now let's see what all entities we are going to create, because we are using MongoDB. So you don't need to define the entity. We just need to create a simple model. Okay. Here I'm going to give you the simple setup for Express TypeScript application, right? So let's say talk about the user model first. So we'll go to the user and user model. This is a TypeScript file. So here we are going to have a user schema and address schema. So let's create that. First of all, let's import the typings. Import address. Import everything as mongoose from I'm getting this strange error, this typings doesn't exist, but I have already added that. Maybe I will just add the PNPM install at the root. Or I will delete this log file. Okay, PNPM log file. It contains all the dependencies for all the projects. And let's see, mongoose. It is there. 5.8.1. The .ds file contains declaring file mongoose. Okay, so for now I need to fix this, otherwise I cannot use the typings for the mongoose. 5.8.1 implicitly I just need to add this mongoose typings, but that is already there. If you see my package JSON for this project, I added this mongoose typings, types mongoose 5.11. And okay, there may be a mismatch of these version 5.8.11. Maybe it is the issue. And if I try to see, do I have these typings created? 5.11.97. I mean, this is because we have multiple projects and they have their own set of dependencies and on versions. 5.8.11. So finally we killed the monster. The problem here is with this package, because if you have multiple repositories and then you have a different versions of mongoose, then obviously it will create a problem, right? So what I did is I baselined all the mongoose versions to 5.8.11. you can see 5.8.11. I mean, that should be the upper version, 5.8.11, and once you have it, then your issues will be sorted. Because if you look into the PNPM log 5.8.11, you will see for the typings for the mongoose that is same. So once you fix it, then at least this also will start working, because I can detect the typings now, correct typings. And here in my models, now I can create a user model. Right here also it is fine, it is able to detect the type, and my application is also now fine with the mongoose types. So now next thing we are going to do is user model, right? So inside user model, what do we have? We are going to create address schema. So const address schema and user schema. Address schema equal to new mongoose dot schema. Because now we have a TypeScript type, so we can use them. And it will be just like, okay, what do we have? City is of type string. Comma, we have a country which is of type string, and street which is of type string. And then we can have a user schema, const user schema equal to new mongoose dot schema, and there also we can define the whole property. So address is a type, this is a custom type we have created which follows the address schema, and then email is of type string, first name is of type string, S capital should be there, last name is also of type string, and then password. So when you try to get the password, password can also be string and all. But when you try to get the password, what we are saying is it should return you undefined. So this is, I'm going to specify the behavior of the password. It is of type. So this is how you can define, okay, custom attributes, type is string, what happens, okay, double semicolons. And when you try to get it, I should be able to return you undefined. Okay, this is going to be undefined. So what it is taking, undefined, and it is going to return undefined. That is just a way of when you don't want to return the value from the database. Okay, and if you want to just make a string, here also you can just say the type, type string required true, and you can also set unique true. So now we have address schema. So address schema is an embedded reference. We don't need to do referencing here because this is just like a sub document in the JSON object. And now we have, if you see the user model, we have this address. Now we also want to have a posts. So how can we associate the post with the user schema? So how we can do it? We can, you already have a user schema dot virtuals. This is provided by the typings, and here I'm going to associate virtuals with, so there is a posts. We are going to define the relationship. So what is the reference field? So inside that we have a reference field which is going to be with the post, and local field. There are two properties, local field. Local field is underscore id is going to be a foreign field, foreign key inside the another table. So that is a foreign field author. So inside a post collection there will be an author which will be referred to the user. Okay, and then once you have it, I mean, we can also have a virtuals. Virtuals are actually properties of Mongoose that will help you to associate, that will help you to populate a new column, all those things. So your full name is a new column which is coming by concatenating the first name and the last name. And here virtuals can be helpful for populating the data from one reference to another reference. So this is going to create a relationship. Like we have one-to-one, one-to-many, many-to-many in the type ORMs and SQLize. Similarly, we can define the virtuals. So you don't need to, you know, here we are creating actually the reference. And then const user model. Finally, we are creating a model, mongoose.model of which type? So we are creating a either of type user. And this is mongoose.document. Mongoose.document. And how you are going to refer it? The name of the model is user. We are just adding the types, nothing much. And then here is the user schema. So user is actually a type. So we are going to create an interface. Import user from user interface. So this is like a custom type we can create. User interface will contain the user type. So this is the user interface. Here we have ID, first name, last name, full name, email, password, address. Okay, address is optional, email, password, full name, underscore ID. So this type we are passing to this. And we have phone and username. We already have, I think. We don't need to add any additional columns. Okay, this is fine. So what it is giving? It is giving us the user document which contains these types. Right, first name, last name. So these types will be helpful when you are writing a query to the MongoDB. This is how we define the typings, because TypeScript is important part here. This model is creating the document, and here we are exporting this user model object. So here we finally we can export model.export, export default user model. That's it. So now we are going to work on the post model. So inside post also we have post model, and we will see how we can define the relationship. So import everything from Mongoose Okay, what if this import everything as mongoose from mongoose? Okay, and here const post schema equal to new mongoose dot schema, and we will specify the schema. Okay, we are going to have author. Author is going to use a reference user. So what is the reference here? Because it is coming from the user collection, and type is object ID because we are going to store the user object ID here. Mongoose dot schema dot types dot object ID. So this is how the TypeScript helps while writing code. And other than that, you can have a simple content which is of type string, and title which is of type string. I'm not building an API here, I'm just trying to show you how it really works. Const post model. So this is another model we are creating, mongoose dot model. We need to define the type for this. Either it is going to be a post interface which we will create, or mongoose dot document, and this is going to be post and post schema, and then export default. Default post model and post interface we need to create. Post interface will have just a couple of attributes which we can put here, interface post, and I can import the post interface. That's it. So modeling is important. Now you can have another collection which is maybe the comments. Okay, like let's say if I create a comment model, then how you define the relationship and how you define the comment model.ts. okay, so here I will just do is comment schema. Comment will also be added by some user, right? So here it will be just a comment title. So here we can create another relationship with the comment schema. So instead of post schema, there will be a comment schema. I mean, you can create interface and all, but this is how it really works and how you will add a virtuals in the user model, same as this. But what we are doing is one user can have multiple posts. Similarly, one user can have multiple comments. So this is for the comment. Local field is ID and the foreign field is author. So in the post comment model, we have author property. So local field is the ID. The ID of this user will be referenced as object ID inside a comment model. This is what it is telling you. Okay, so let's just work on the user and the comments. This is how the relationship works in MongoDB. So we have, now we can create a controllers like user controller, post controller, and then we will add authentication layer on top of that. So controller will also be a class. Okay, because we have the interface, we can create a DTOs. What the DTO will contain? User DTO, because in user we are taking some inputs, right? So we can use the class validator for validating the DTO. So import stuff from class validator, the data class validator which we will define, and here class create user DTO, and here I can just use the properties. What all properties do we have? I will just create the DTO and then I will show you. It is a simple class. This is how we can use it. Each string is defined, all these properties you can add using class validator, and we can also have a address DTO. Address DTO, because here let's say create address DTO class, create address DTO. Because here we are doing a nested payload validations. In NestJS, people already aware how it works. Because inside user, we are creating the address. So I will keep taking these three fields because there are three fields we have. Street, city, country. City and country. These are all required. we can make it optional here. If you are passing it here, you can see is optional, validate nested and create address DTO. That's it. So now we can just talk about the user controller, how we are going to implement a user controller. So first of all, we can just create a simple user controller that is going to be a simple class, class user controller. And here we are going to add the constructor. Okay, this constructor will contain, okay, this dot initialize initialize controller, but this particular controller it will initialize. So how the simple controller looks like, okay, this here we can also implement controller the type we have created. Okay, so if we are using them, then okay, this is the controller type which contains the path and the router. So I will add those properties public path. What is the path of this controller? Users and public router. This is the router which we are using, the express router for it. So the router we can import, okay, the router will be coming from express, import stuff from express. So here we are going to import request, response, next function and the router. Okay, and now initialize controller or initialize routes, because we are already inside the controller, we will just say initialize the routes. So what all routes we are going to create inside our application. So initialize routes, and here I can create private method, private initialize routes, and here we can access this dot router. We already have a router instance, right? This dot router dot get, and then how we are going to pass the path, because there is a base path. So I will pass the base path something like this, this dot path. After base path we can add the ID. So I'm trying to get the user, and here we can add the middleware, otherwise this dot get user by ID. So this is the method I'm going to create in this class. And similarly we can have another methods, give me all the posts, right? For this particular ID, give me all the posts. Here also we are going to add a middleware, so get all posts of user. So these are the two methods we are going to define. So these are the private methods. I can just create private get user by ID, and it will contain all the three attributes, request, response and next function. Request is of type request, response is of type response, next is of type next function. Okay, and here we are going to get the ID from the request params, request dot parents dot ID. And we are going to trigger the user query. How it looks like is this dot user dot find by ID. So we also need to get the models, because we have database models, right? So here I will do it something like this, public user equal to user model. We need to import it, user model, public post. This is how you can just convert these functions into the classes, post model. Okay, now you can access using this dot user, this dot user dot find by ID. There is a method already, you just pass the ID which you are getting in the params. So find by ID, and then so there is another query, like here what you are doing, get user by ID, you already have the user, so you can just return it if user is there, just return it. Otherwise response dot send, otherwise what we will do is next we can call another exception, no user not found exception. So we are going to throw the custom exception for this. If user is there, first of all, this is a user query, and we can populate the data for this const user equal to user query dot populate. This is how we do it. I mean, this is really promise based. User query.exe. If you want to populate the posts also with this, then you can use populate, because we already have a reference, populate posts. That's it. So it will give me the user object. If user is there, I will just say, okay, response dot send user. Otherwise, I need to create this exception, and then similarly, we will create this method, get all post of user. So these two APIs, first is giving the user ID, and then another is fetching all the posts created by the user. Okay, get all posts of user. I mean, the structure will be same, but data directly or indirectly is kind of similar. So user not found exception, this we can create as a custom exception inside our exceptions. So here is exceptions. I can create a user dot exceptions dot ts, and I can just extend the HTTP exception. So there are some HTTP exceptions we can define. I can create HTTP exception dot ts. So how the normal exceptions look like? Class HTTP exception extend, because somewhere you need to extend, either you extend the error class here or you extend here. I'm extending HTTP exception there, so that I'm getting from HTTP exception. Here I need to default export default HTTP exception. And then how you extend the error class, you will have a two properties, public status of string, public status number, the status code of the API, and then public message is of type string. And here there is a constructor inside that you can pass both the parameters. First of all, super message, you can need to call the parent class constructor by passing the message. And then we are already getting a status and message here. Status is of type number, and then message is of type string. And here we can just pass the message, and this dot status equal to the status which we are passing. And if you wanted to show the stack trace also, then you can decide what you want to do. So this is like a custom HTTP exception class we have created. Now you can create your own exceptions by extending HTTP exception. User not found exception, and you need to pass the ID. And here we are passing the ID also, and you need to import this here. Sorted, right? And we will be handling these custom exceptions at a middleware level. And now we come back to the user controller. Here now, get all posts of a user. So the API is, this is the user ID, give me all the posts. So first of all, we'll get the user ID. And now what we are going to do, in the params we got the user ID, so I can simply create a query, this dot post dot find, post dot find, simple operation, find where author is that, right? So author is this user ID which we are passing. Author is equal to this ID, and there is an author column in the posts, so I can just pass this. So and then we can do await, simply await this dot posts, this dot post dot find. This can be async method. Get all the posts, and I mean, depends on how you want to create it. You can also create these methods something like this, or make them async. If this is a variable, async, and here you can do await. await this dot post dot find and pass the author ID. And then if this is the data is there, response dot send. Here, what do we need to send? A users data, I mean simply data. Okay, we'll talk about the middlewares later, because what we want is no one else apart from the himself should be able to fetch the posts. So what we need to do is here, what we need to do a checks, and those checks are, this would be the arrow function. Those checks are, because when we write a middleware, we will populate the user object of the session. Session user in request. So here we can check that whatever the user ID you are passing, the ID you are passing should be equal to the user which exists inside a request.user.id. If both are same, that means the user who has its own blog, like user who is logged in, is accessing his own blogs, his own ID. If user ID of the current logged in user and the ID you are passing both are same, that means you can allow. Otherwise, you can send not authorized exceptions. A custom exception we can create. So this is simple user controller. Now what we did is simple get user by ID and all. Now let's see what we are adding next. So we can also create authentication controller. So we have authentication controller is going to use our same user model, right? So here I'm going to create auth dot controller dot ts auth dot service dot ts. So auth dot controller. Now we already familiar like how we are creating a controllers and all. Auth dot controller is going to access auth routes, right? So I can just create a simple class. So now let's create auth controller and auth service. So controller will be created in the same way we created a user controller. So I will copy some of the things from here. So here, this is our auth controller. Initialize routes. Here we are going to use user model. Post model we don't need. And here the route will be auth. This is going to be auth controller. Implements controller. So here we need a service also, and we are not using NestJS. So how we are going to inject this service? So let's create a simple structure of service class authentication service. So this is class authentication service, and it is going to use user model, which we can import, and then it is going to have a couple of methods, because all the methods which are going to deal with authentication, like public async, register, and then public async login. So one is a register, and then we also need to, once user is registered, we are going to create a user, and using the login we are going to compare the password with the password which you are sending. So let's say first create a register, and here we will do export default. So we will export default authentication service. So this authentication service, now we can inject this. How we will inject? We are not using any dependency injection mechanism. So this service, we can just add the instance of this inside a controller. And how we do it in just the same legacy way. Here I can just do is a public authentication service equal to new authentication service. And we can use this authentication service like this. Okay, now we have initialized routes. So initialized routes we are going to define private initialized routes. Here we are going to register all the routes we are going to have inside this. So what we will do is this dot router dot post. We can copy the user controller routes, and we will change the logic, and we will change the methods and all. This is our auth controller. So here the routes will be this dot router dot post. Here we are going to do is auth register. Then we have auth login. So these are our primary routes for the authentication. Now we can define these respective methods in the controller and then services. So this dot register, we will call register. This dot login can be a login, and then there is a logout. So register, login and logout, these are the primary methods we have. We will define that inside a controller, and then the same methods we will define inside our services. So register, login, logout. Here we need to add a middleware also, because what we have is we have created DTOs. If you remember, we have this user DTO that we can use while creating a user, and then we have this login DTO that we can use while doing a login, because what we are expecting that you need to pass email and a password. Either we can use a Joy validator, and inside this here we can pass the middleware, right? Otherwise, let's create these middlewares later, but those middlewares will validate the payload that you are passing that particular criteria or not, like email and password, both properties are there or not. If not, then it will send a bad request 400. So now we can create these methods, which is private register, and these can be the same async methods. I will try to copy some of the existing methods and we'll replicate it for all of our implementations. So here this first method is this, then second method, this is the login, register and logout, right? So I will change it to the login, this to register, and then this is logout. Okay, we have these three methods. Now on the login, what we are going to get, we are going to get the payload from the body. So here instead of this, what we will do is a request.body, and what will the payload looks like. So it's a login data of type login DTO. We will validate it. For now we'll just use it, and here we can just check this is the login, right? So here we can just check const user equal to await this dot user dot find one. Based on this criteria, here we are passing, okay, is the email already, email exists in the database. So this is the login data dot email. And if user exists, right, if user not found, then we can throw this. Otherwise, we need to play with this. User not found exception. Have we created it? It's there, right? So we just need to, using next function, because we already have a middleware which is handling this user not found exception. Okay, what happened? We need to pass the ID. So instead of that wrong credential, I mean, we don't need to use this exception. We can create another exception, is user not found exception, and then invalid credential passed. I mean, it's just a custom exception. So we will just pass email as a string and invalid credential passed. Doesn't exist. Okay, and we will just use this exception in our auth controller. We can import it. That's it. Okay. That is when, what is this, it needs one argument. Okay, so we'll just pass the email login DTO, login data dot email. That is the case when user is not found. Okay, if user is there, I'm just thinking how we should write it. If user is there, then I will just check is password match. Okay, I can use this thing, authentication service, or I can write a simple bcrypt.compare. vcrypt.compare. And what we need to compare, we need to compare the login data dot password. Vcrypt we need to import on the top. So here vcrypt.compare login data dot password, and then we need to get the another password which is there in the database. So for that I can just do user dot get, because in this user entity I'm just making already inside this user model. So how we can get that then inside an authentication controller? So for that we need to do a little hack, login detail dot password here. Now the second argument is the password which is there in the database. So here we can do it something like this, user dot get. This is the method provided by Mongoose model. I'm looking for password. Okay, and if you see this get takes a couple of arguments, type options, right? So type is null and option is getters false. So it will just give me the password value, and if it is match found, if is match, that means we got the match for the password, then we can just talk about creating token and all. This dot authentication service dot create token, instead of this I will just call this dot generate token, and here this dot create token, and we are passing user. And once it is there, what we will do is response dot set header. There is a method set header, and we will do set cookies. So what we will do is set cookie, and here we need to create the cookie. So I will just call another method for that, create cookie, and I will be getting a token data. Okay, and then response dot send user object. So I just need to send this cookies, which is nothing but a token. So we'll write this method, create token, private generate token, and we are getting the user object. User is of type user. It should give me the token data. I mean, we can create this interface, simple interface inside. We can create this interfaces. Okay, so we can create a token data interface or token interface dot ts. It's better to create a separate files. So this is the token data. I need a token and expire in properties. So this is going to return me the token data. And this is simple method. It is taking user as an input, right? So now what we are going to do, we are going to create a const expire in. So what is expiry? Let's say an hour. I think these are the milliseconds. And here we can have a const secret equal to process dot env dot secret, JWT secret, and const the data which we are going to store inside this data stored in token. Data stored in token is another interface that is going to have underscore id, which is user dot id, because this is the only thing which we are referring here and there. And then we can just return expire in and the token. How we are going to create token using JWT. So that we are going to get from JSON web token dot sign. So let's first import JWT from JSON web token. And we are creating a token. So JWT dot sign. Sign and verify, there are two methods, right? Sign is to create a token. So here it takes two arguments, dot sign, the payload, right? So data stored in the token and secret and expire in property. This will create a token for us. The type is for this is user, from user interface, token data. We can import. This is, you can set anything, any, otherwise you can create some interface for it. Okay, this is generate token. So generate token is giving us expire in and token, two properties. And here we are creating create cookies. So let's define this method also. Private create cookies. What this method is taking? Token as an input, right? Token is of type token data. And inside this, I'm just going to access the create, token property only. What it is going to return, how our cookies looks like. So cookie should be token dot token. This is the property. This is like a cookie string we are creating, HTTP. You can take a reference how to create a cookie. Max age equal to, so this is token dot expire in property. That's it. So this is going to return us cookies. So we are setting that inside a header and we are returning it. So this is a simple login we have done. All these methods we have written for login. Right now there is a register. Registration is simple. If you look into this, what we are going to get, we are going to get the data of create user DTO. User data of type create user DTO. And then here we will put everything inside a try catch. I will validate it once I'm done halfway, 90% done. Then we will just try to play with all these APIs and see if we are receiving any error. So here I'm going to get the user and I can call the authentication service, this dot authentication service dot register, and I can pass the user data. And once the user is created, we can send this user. So response dot send this user object. So this user object we are getting dot user data. User data is of type create user DTO. So this data is of type create user DTO. Now we are adding, what will be authentication service contains here. First we need to check if this email exists, right? So we should be having email property inside this data. So what we can do is const user equal to this dot find one email. If user already exists, then we can throw an exception, which can be throw new user with already exist. So we can create a custom exception, user with that email already exist exception. Provided email already exists. And now there you can just throw this exception from your auth controller. So here you are calling service, throw new user already exists with exception with this email. You just import this exception and we are good. Okay, this is when user already exists. Otherwise what we will do is we'll create a hash version of the password. This is very simple demo which I have already covered here and there. Bcrypt we need to import. Bcrypt dot hash. Let's first import bcrypt. JWT and bcrypt both we need, so we can import on the top. Bcrypt dot hash, what it needs, a user data dot password and the salt value. So here it can create the password value, and then what we can do is const user equal to await this dot user dot create. So this dot user model, this dot user dot, there should be a method create. Okay, create is taking your user your data which you are passing, and then we need to override the value of the password. So that will be password equal to s password. Yeah, that's it. So existing user, let's change the variable. If user already exists, then do this. So we got the hash password. We created a user. and then we can just return this user. So that is simple register, right? We are not doing much here. What happened? So this register we can import, authentication service already being provided to the auth controller, and we are doing simple register response.send. Otherwise we can just call next error middleware, right? So let's create this error middleware also, because we need it at different places. So inside a middlewares, what we can do is we can create error.ts, and what this middleware contains, a simple function error middleware, which is taking error, can be of type HTTP exception, and then request is of type request coming from express, response coming from response, and the next function. These are the arguments for this next function. Okay, and now, so this is simple function, because a middleware is nothing but a function. This autocompletes looks correct, response dot. So we need to get the status, const status first of all. What is the status, so that we can get from error if it is coming. Otherwise we will set our default status to 500, and message, const message, if it is coming from error dot message, otherwise say is something wrong which we don't know, we need to debug. And then response dot status, we already got the status dot send. What happened? Response dot status, response is coming from, what happened, this should be coming from request, response dot status equal to status is number. What happened with this expression is not callable, response dot status. Okay, let me see what is wrong. We are getting all these from the express. Okay, the typing is not correct. Now this is good, response dot status dot send. So inside send we can send a message or the status both. That's it. So this is error middleware we can use everywhere, wherever we want to register it, right? So we will be registering it somewhere, and that we are doing here first of all. So all the unknown exceptions will come here. What happened? Are we not exporting it? Yes, we are not exporting it. Export default error middleware, and let's go to app.ts, import error middleware. So now wherever you are throwing an exception, so these all will be caught or captured by this. So inside authentication controller we can just simply say next error. So this is our authentication controller, next error, this will be handled by the error middleware. Similarly the logout, so we have covered a login register, and then there is a logout. So what will be logout will do? Logout will do nothing much, it will just set the cookies to 200, response.status, response.send 200, and here what it will do is response dot, because what we are doing logout, so we will just reset the cookies expiry, response dot set header, and what is the header? Set cookie. And this cookie value is this authorization, the same cookie string equal to empty. Okay, and max is of this become 0. That's it, that will do the job, because here we are doing, okay, maybe I did it. Okay, so here we can see the registration, logging in and logout. Logout is just resetting the cookies, here we are creating the token, and we can test this much. Because, and what all we need to do is we need to import the auth controller. We also have a user controller and the post controller. So this is how it works, right? We are creating app instance, passing the controllers, and then initializing the controller, and we are registering the router, which is exported from each and every controller. Controller.router, right? This is what we have on each and every controller. So when I just trying to play around with this, hello, username is hello, password is, let's say, hello, and I'm doing send. So this is auth register. This is the method we have. So we got logged, we got registered, and then I'm just doing a simple login, email and the password. So this is login, auth login, and I'm getting the token. Let me see, this is auth login. We need to remove this password which we are getting, and here inside the cookies, right? Here I'm getting the cookies, authorization, and the long string, that is a authorization token. That authorization token we will send back in the response. So you can see this was my request, and this is my response which I got. Right here I got the set cookies, this is my payload. Inside set cookies I have authorization with value, and this is actually a cookie. So cookie has a key value, authorization, and this is the value, and HTTP only set, maximum as is 3600 seconds, I guess, and this is it. Now we will just try to add some more middleware, because we have post controller that we will write, and we will pass this cookies in the request headers, and we will validate, okay, user exists, then only we will allow user to access their APIs. So these are like two simple register login, and if you talk about logout, auth logout, then I think it will just set the cookies. You can see content type set cookies, authorization, and maximum is zero. So that means whatever the cookies which was being exchanged between client and server has been set to empty, and the maximum is of that cookie has been set to null, it has expired, right? So that is logout. I can create a duplicate here, auth logout. This we can keep register only. So you can see if you are passing the same user, then user with provided credential already exists. That is coming from the error middleware. Okay, so we made a good progress overall. Now we can work on the post entity, because once user logs in, he will start creating the post, updating the post, deleting the post, and for that the user needs to be logged in. So this is our post controller, DTO, interface, model, and service. So post model we already have, which has a reference of the user, and while creating the post we should have a request.user object in the request, and we will create a post controller. So I will copy my user controller and I will create the post controller from it, because the code is somewhat similar. So what we are doing here is auth is posts. So this is the post controller, right? Initialize route. So I'm going to initialize some of the routes. What all we have is router.get, this dot path. So on the root of the posts, I'm going to call get all posts, get all posts, get post by id. So this is going to be the get, this is get. So here it will be get post by id, post by id. Then we have update. So whatever the routes you are calling now, so you can fetch all the posts, that is public, we don't need a middleware. You can also get individual post, we don't need a middleware for that, because we are considering that this is public API. But when it comes to updating a post or deleting a post, right, these APIs we want to keep protected. Why? Because we are going to allow only those users who have access can create and update and delete. These are the different methods we are going to do. So there is a post delete patch, these all these paths. So this is the path we have, anything which is coming after this path. So post, and then this is router.all, because here we are going to create multiple entries with this. So here we can say dot patch, and then you can do a good dot get, right? This is how the router works. Dot post, here we are creating a post. So post this dot router dot all, router dot all this dot path. You don't need to specify the handler for this. So this is the prefix. On top of that, I'm going to create all these routes. This dot path. So I'm going to create auth middleware. And we also need to validate the payload that we will create later, create post. That is the method we will create. So this is, and then we have a delete, because you can delete a post. So this dot path, that will be a little dynamic, because what we need to pass is this dot path. Path forward slash ID. This is like, okay, I'm selecting a particular post and auth middleware, because you cannot delete a post until unless you are not logged in. Delete post. And similarly, patch is to update a particular post. I will apply the same changes here. This is patch auth middleware. This is update post. Simple, right? So this is what we are going to do. We are going to define all these methods: middleware, update post, delete post, get all post. So let's say get all post. Let's define the first method, what it will contain. We are not getting any ID. So here it is saying is this dot post dot found, post dot find, and no ID. That means we want all the posts. So this is post query, and we can populate also data. I mean, we can populate the user data also with each and every post. Populate author, because post contains the author. So we want to populate this, and we wanted to exclude the password field from that. So that's it. Populate. This will give me the data. This is going to give me all the posts that I can send. So I can simply send is response dot send. If the posts are there, we will be able to send it. Otherwise, it will send an empty array. Response dot send post. So await this dot find. Okay, we can just do await on this post query dot populate. So this is just like a get all post, get post by ID. So here also we can do the same thing, get post by ID. First we need to get the ID from the params. So here I'm doing is const ID equal to request dot params dot ID. So I got the ID. What you need to do with the ID is you can just pass this ID here, find by ID. There is a method provided by Mongoose, find by ID, and pass the ID. Okay, post query, and we just need to get this data, right? So we can just do await directly here, this dot find by ID. So I'm just getting a single post. So if post is there, we can also do, okay, find by ID, post is there. Otherwise we can just send not found exception. Like, let's say if you are passing the wrong object ID. So I mean, if you want, you can return something like this. So here, if it is a post is there, then we will just send response dot send. Otherwise, in else, we can just write throw an exception, new post not found exception. This is a custom exception you can create for this ID. New post not found exception. I can just say post.exception.ts. This is the name. I think we can just copy any of it. And I will just say post not found exception. This is again 404. And I will just say post not found for ID. We will be just passing the ID as a string, and this is post not found exception. I will be importing this post not found exception. And these are not being imported correctly. You need to fix the path of the import. There is a typo in the name, so we'll fix it. Okay, now this is the post controller. Now get all get by ID. Now modify post. So I will just copy this thing. First we need to check if we have that post or not. So here what I'm doing is update post. So we will get the params, and then we will also get the body post data of type post from request.body. You can also set the type any for now, or you can create some type for it. So here we can just use await post this dot post dot find by ID and update, a simple method which is there, find by ID and update. So what we are updating, this particular ID, and we are updating with the post data. And if new, I mean, this is I think upsert operation. And if post is there, send it, otherwise not found exception. Similarly, there is a find by ID and delete. Update post, and then I can just do delete post. Here we don't need anything in the body. I will be just sending find by ID and delete. Find by ID and remove and delete. What is the difference? Find by ID issue, find commands by this document ID field. So this is same as delete, finds a matching document, removes it. Okay. So this is find by ID and delete. If success response, if we got success response, that means it has been deleted. Otherwise, we can just say post not found exception. So this is simple. Now we also have a create post, right? That we haven't created. Create post. So same thing, we are going to get the payload now from the body, so that we will get, we don't have here the create post DTO we can create. So what do we have in the post DTO? Just only two properties, title and string. So post controller, we can import that here, and here request.body. And here what we will do is simply create post. So const create post, post equal to new this dot post, and here we can pass the payload. So we have post data and the author is another argument, right? And here author, how we can get request dot user dot underscore ID. So this is the catch here, how we can populate, how we can add the types request.user. So here we are going to create a new type, request with user. So request with user, it can be our interface. Okay, let's go to this is request.user.ts. What we will do is interface request with user, that way is going to extend a request coming from express, and here we are going to populate the user type inside that, and then export default request with user, and this user is actually a type we already have. And this express, this request is coming from express. Simple. So here we are not going to put request. Instead of that, request with user, because we are going to access request.user property from that. So if we are able to create a post successfully, so this is the created post, and then here I will say is const save post equal to await created post dot save. This is how we create a record in the MongoDB. And finally, we also need to return something, right? So we can populate some data or response dot send saved post. For now, let's return it. So these are all the methods we have. Auth middleware. Now we will create auth middleware. What is auth middleware here? Create post. Let me just see. Okay, now we are going to create auth middleware. Okay, we need to fix the path. Otherwise, our compiler will complain. So this is our post controller. All the paths are fixed. Now we are going to create middlewares. So what all middleware we have? Error middleware we already have. That is just to handle all the error thrown from the controller. Then we can create a auth middleware. So I will copy this and I will create auth.middleware. And change the code. So let's create auth middleware. Auth middleware is will take all these three arguments: request, response, and next function. So let's replace the whole body. Request, response, next function. Okay, what it is going to have? Auth middleware. This is request with user. Now what all code it will have is, first of all, we need to get the cookies from request, because when you are doing a login, which we have already discussed here, what we are doing is we are sending this cookies, right? Which is the name is authorization and the value is this. So you will be coming back with the same cookies to access the protected APIs. So here I'm doing request.cookies, and if cookies are there and add cookies.authorization. So cookie contains this authorization cookies. If it is there, then we are good. So if cookie contains authorization, otherwise we are not good, right? You are not passing the authorization header. New authentication token missing. Auth token missing. And you can send 403 auth token missing. So this is a custom exception you can throw. Auth dot token dot exception TS. So here you can just throw auth token missing exception. That is going to return 403 auth token missing exception. Okay, no arguments. This is going to extend the HTTP exception. Auth token missing. Okay, and we can import this in the middleware. That is the first case, right? Now there will be multiple. First is cookies is there. Then what we will do is we will get the secret using which we have created the token. We can get it from process.env.secret. And here we are going to verify const verify equal to ZWT. Okay, we are going to import JSON web token JWT from JSON web token, and we are going to do is JWT.verify. So JWT.verify contains two arguments, cookies.authorization. So this is the string which you are passing. And I'm going to validate it against the secret JWT.verify, as, and it is going to give me the data payload, right? Once you verify it, this is the verify response will contain that data, and then we are going to get the ID, const ID, which will be the user ID. So verify response dot underscore ID, and then we can get the user from it. Await user model dot find by ID, because whatever the ID you are putting in the token, we will try to just get it. If this token exists, real user exists with this token or not. And once you get the user, if user is there, what we will do is we will set that user on the request object, request.user, and the next. Otherwise, we will set next new wrong authentication credential passed. I think I created exception for that. Wrong credential exception or bad request. Oh, we can create auth token exception. Then I will just create another exception. Wrong auth token passed, right? Wrong auth token passed. Wrong auth token passed. Let's copy this exception and put this in the middleware. This is when the user doesn't exist, okay? So if user is there, then do this, else wrong token passed. And if anything wrong, like we can also wrap it inside a try catch, cookies dot authorization, because we are doing verify. So verify can be a part of try catch block. If there is any error, in that case, we can just do the same next. So this is our simple middleware. If everything is good, we will do the next. If user is there, add that user in the request.user and do the next. Otherwise, throw these appropriate exceptions and just pass this middleware. Now this middleware we are passing only in the post controller. So let's import this middleware. And now we should be able to test it. Test the end-to-end functionality. Okay, create, update, delete. Let's test the end-to-end, and then we will add some test cases and we will wrap up with the whole demo process. Okay, the only thing is we can also add a validation middleware that I will do in the last. Let's first test it. So let's add this post controller in the root. So here we are doing export default post controller and go to app.ts. Sorry, server.ts, because here we are adding all of these new post controller, and we also have a new user controller. There was a user controller. I forgot the export default for it. Export default user controller, and here I was talking about request.user, right? Because we want to give a user only those posts which user has written, right? So here we can just see if id request.params.id should be equal to get all posts of user. So id is the user id. It should be equal to request.user. Here this will be the request with user. With user, okay, and then request.user dot id. If both are same, if both are not same, if both are same, then we are good. I can send you this data. Otherwise, next, unauthorized user exception or something like that. this exception we can create. So inside exception, user exists exception, I can create a custom exception, user exists exception.ts. This is the authorized exception. Unauthorized exception. So this would be 401. We will change the message. So this is a user controller. Unauthorized exception we can import. You just don't need to pass any ID or something like that. So export default user controller. Register this user controller at your server. New user controller. Import this user controller and fix all these things because these are not imported correctly. Similarly, do you see anything? Exceptions. Or we need to go back. Exceptions. Interface. Exceptions. Just fix all these things wherever you see. Okay, I think this is post model. Okay, once that is done, you should be able to start the application and then we will just play with the APIs. So here we can see I should be able to create a post, right? So this is my API. This is the simple login. I'm able to log in and I got the response. This is the cookies, right? We are receiving. And this cookies is being set here also. If you see the last part is RAHTRA. And the same we are getting. HTRA, this is the cookies we are receiving right now. I should be able to access the post API, like create post. So create post is taking some body. So here is a post controller and I will talk about the create post. Create post TTO, which is title and content. So I'll just change it to title and content. And if you see, I'm not passing the cookies here. So this is my request headers, right? I'm not passing cookies. So I will be getting is 401 unauthorized auth token missing in the cookies. So first of all, we need to manage, we need to send the cookies in the header so that I can access this protected API. And let's see if I try to get all the posts. So let's go to post controller. These are all the routes we have. Get all path, get request, get by ID. So if I do simple get requests, posts, it will give me currently there is no post. And if you can pass the post ID also. First of all, let's create a post. So I will just pass create post protected and then I will create a duplicate. Fetch posts that is not protected. Here I can just do simply get. It is going to return empty, but create post here we need to send the cookies back to the server so that here this is our auth middleware that can validate our cookies which we are getting inside that are we passing authorization or not. If yes, then it will allow us to access the API. So here we can pass here we can manage the cookies in the Insomnia, and you can see these cookies are automatically sent with relevant request. So here the domain is path is /, HTTP only, domain is localhost. So for all the requests this is going to be passed. So I'm going to click on done. I will just set, you can see it is creating the random IDs, title and content, ID author. We can also fetch the more information about the posts. Let's see if I do the fetch posts, I can see this, right? Oh, who is the author ID? So that means we are not storing. Let's see the create post title and content that is missing, right? So let's go to the create post method inside a post controller. This is create post, this dot path auth middleware create post. And here request dot body post data. What is wrong with this? Created post, this dot post. Post is pointing to the post model. Okay, post data contains both the properties, which is content and title. That is strange. It is not being passed. So we need to debug post data, and then I'm just overriding it with the Auth author. Otherwise, I can just do is create post dot author content equal to post data dot content created post dot title equal to post data dot title. I mean, ideally it should. Here we can just set it like this only, created equal to new this dot post. Let's do it like this. So here created post dot author. So there is author IDs which we can get from request dot user. request.user.underscore ID. Right, so let's create a post now and see if it is updating. It's not even passing author now. That's strange. If I try to fetch all the posts, okay, something wrong with this create post. Then let's see what we are doing. This dot post, we are creating the constructor, created post, and then dot save. I mean, there are many ways to do it. You create the instance of your model and set all these properties and then save it. I want to populate author minus password. Let's see if it can populate a post with author. So here I will create a post. Okay, let's debug this thing. So here initialize routes, create post. We can just try another way, this dot post dot create. This dot post dot, there is a method I think, create, and here we can pass post data, and we have author that we can pass from request dot user dot underscore ID. This dot post dot create, and so this is created post. We can take the reference from the user, how we are creating it. So authentication controller, auth service. You can just do await this, and this would be able to create a post for us. So post controller, await this dot post, created post. Let's see this one. Okay, that is strange. Created post, is it coming empty? This dot post dot create, we are sending the document post data and then author object, which is a reference. Let's try this with this approach. Okay, I was missing await, and then let me just try to log also what we are getting in the post data. I will do the create. Oh, this is going empty. So create post, is it post or not? Create post is a post method. Okay, this is also post. Then the path is this dot path auth middleware, and then create post. This is post. So whatever we are sending as a body JSON, that should be forwarded, title and content. Now I somehow got it, or why this body is coming as an empty request.body. So this is create post. I'm still thinking request.body. So this is express request.body. So this is readable socket event. That is the only last thing. I mean, the APIs we are able to access because this is the protected endpoint. but somehow this body is being passed as an empty. That is a concern. Okay, so user object I have on the request object, body is being passed as an empty. Why that is happening? So let's go to the global middleware we have. I think I may know the region. App.ts, we are not registering the middleware, which is body parser we already using. Bodyparser.json. Maybe this can be the issue. Okay. So somehow I'm still fixing this. I need to fix this because title and content, when I'm passing in the fetch post, that is somehow not, because this body is not being forwarded and I'm not able to understand why this body is not being passed. I already have a body parser middleware and this is HTTP post, and I'm getting this empty body object while I'm handling the request in the create post. That I will try to fix it and I will post a fix for that. But overall, this is how it is working. We are doing a simple login. Okay, I commented some code to debug the problem, but it was taking some time. So I commented out the controller part. Now I will just revert that back. So this is how we are doing a simple login. This is the cookies we are getting, and that same cookies is being forwarded. So whenever you are passing the posts, right, the same cookie data is being passed in the cookies, and we are extracting that inside our middleware. So this is our auth middleware we have created that is handling the request cookies. So here you can actually try to also log something, user found and all. But if you are trying to, if you are not sending these cookies, then you will get a missing token exception, or if a user doesn't exist in the database after getting the token, then also you will get the error that wrong token is being passed. So this is like a simple demo I try to create by using Express TypeScript. And here the important part is how we structure the code. Now implementation is fixed. I mean, that is a small bug we can fix. Here you can see authentication, all the middleware, all the controllers, domain based models, user controller services, all the things will go here. The DTO, you can also create a validation middleware where you can use these DTO classes to validate the payload, or you can use simple Joy. Post controller model DTOs are here. All the middlewares, like you can add a logger middleware, tracer middleware, rate limit middleware, all the middleware here. Authentications, all these things here. So what I can do is I can create a version 2 of this same project to add the migrations, because this is currently being done with the help of Mongoose. We can make it, make all the missing pieces if that is needed, like adding some more middleware, adding some more security, all those concepts. And this is small bug fix. I will keep you posted the fix for that. Okay, that's all about this particular video where we have covered Express, TypeScript, Mongoose with the proper folder structure, and we also need to write some tests. So let's do that in the part 2 of this video.